Flor Peeters was born in 1903, and for almost 50 years now he's been organist of the Cathedral of Saint-Rambourg in Malines. During those years he's become celebrated all over the world, both as a recitalist and composer. To start this evening's programme, I want you to hear Flor Peeters playing one of his best-known pieces on the Malines organ. It's the aria, Opus 51, which shows the organ at its simplest and most expressive. Flor Peeters playing his own aria. Malines, or to give it its Flemish name, Mechelen, just north of Brussels, is one of those beautiful cities which abound in Belgium, with a large market square, very old houses, and a picturesque bell tower. In Malines, the tower belongs to the Cathedral of Saint-Rambourg. And it's that tower which dominates the city, not only from the flat country outside, but as you walk about the streets. It's always there. Not only in sight, but in sound. The sound you hear as you cross the square to enter the cathedral. Well, here we are in the large organ gallery of the Cathedral of Saint Rombo in Malines. And as I said just now, I always associate the church with two, or perhaps it should be three things. The enormous tower with its carillon of 49 bells, and of course, the music and playing of Flor Peeters. But before we talk about you, can you tell me just a little about the church? It's Gothic, but not all of the same period.
One of the first churches here from Malines has been built in the 12th and the 13th century. But the real cathedral was built by the great architect Keldermans, and that was around the 15th century. And of course, they have been building many, many, many years to achieve, to finish this great cathedral, because it took a lot of time and it took also a lot of money.
And they never did collect enough money to finish the tower.
Well, they had the idea to make a tower from 165 meters, I think, and stopped at the building, I think, 97 meters. But for me, it's large and it's high enough.
This is Belgium's Metropolitan Cathedral, mm-hmm. The equivalent, I suppose, of Canterbury.
I mean, that's the same, yes. It's the first Metropolitan Cathedral of Belgium because we have always had the cardinals.
There seems to have been a connection with England in the early 1920s, the days of the famous Cardinal Mercier.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Cardinal Mercier was a great cardinal. He was one of the first to bring together the Anglican and the Catholic churches.
He was very much ahead of his time.
Well, for his time, he was very advanced, of course.
And now, let's hear something about yourself. You were born not very far away from here. When did you start to play the organ?
Well, they told me, because I was so young, that I have played services when I was 7 and 8 years. But I don't remember that anymore. It's so long. And I got my first lessons from my father, who was organist and postmaster in a little village, Tielen, not far from the Dutch border. Later, I had a very good teacher who had his degree from the Lemmens Institute in Mechelen. And so he introduced me to the Lemmens Institute, where I began my studies just after the war.
Who did you study with?
I studied for organ with Oscar de Puyt, who was my predecessor here, too, in the cathedral as organist, and he was an old student of Lemmens. I studied with Canon van Uffel and with Lodewijk Mortelmans. He became later the director of the Flemish Conservatoire in Antwerpen. I did contrapunt and fugue.
You've been organist here since when?
Since 23. I became organist on the time that Cardinal Mercier still was here. So that makes next year, it will be my 50th anniversary. It's a long time.
It's a long time, but it doesn't look as if it's been nearly as long. Now, what do your duties actually entail? You don't have anything to do with the choir, do you?
No, never had something to do with the choir. We had always here a choir master, independent from the organist.
When did the cathedral acquire its first organ?
We had organ builders here in the cathedral very early in the 16th century. Gillis Brabos was building one of the first organs. And until the end of the 17th century, it was Van Petegem from Ghent who built the large organ for the cathedral. But this organ was not on this place. It was in the transept. And it's only in 1850 that the organ has been built here on this place in the West Gallery, where it is now.
And I believe the organ that Brabos built in 1565 was destroyed by the English.
There seems to be.
The organ that now stands dates from 1958. But you've been planning it a long while before that, as long as I've known you, in fact.
Well, it took indeed a long time, because we had already plans before the war. And after the war, it was still difficult to get enough money and subsidies to build a large instrument as this has been done. And then in 58, yes, we got this new instrument. It was a restoration. We held some good stops of Van Petegem. But as you see now, it's a real large cathedral organ, and with a modern and very practical console, and with four manuals and 83 real stops.
Yes, when you were planning it, you travelled about a lot to have a look at different organs in different countries.
Yes.
Where did you go?
Well, we were going to England first, because I had always a real, sincere admiration for the building of your organs, even when they were sometimes a little bit conservative, and that was the reason that I took the organ builder with me to London to see the Festival Hall, to see the Westminster Cathedral, and to see more organs. In the meantime, I got also good advice from my friends, organ builders, Johannes Kleis from Bonn and Flentrop from Amsterdam. It's an ideal organ as a church organ. At the same time, it's a beautiful organ to play concerts, and it was our idea to make the organ in its design for the two purposes.
Well, the majority of the pipes, I'm sure, are new, but I believe you said that it was some of the old von Peterchen pipes still in the organ. Do you think you could let us hear just one or two of those?
Yes, it will be a pleasure for me. We have not very much, but we have suddenly a few very nice stops. And I should like to show you the diapason, 8 foot, of the bovenwerk, that means of the swell. This was on the diapason of the swell, and a beautiful stop that we got from Peterchen, and that is the cornet of the great organ. That's the old stop, and it's beautiful now set on the great. And then a few other things, perhaps the reeds, the pedal reeds, the bassoon, the bombard and the trumpet, and also the 32 foot, we reserved them from Van Peterchen, and they are still here on the organ. And this is the bombard 16 on the pedal. This is the bombard with the trumpet. On the bombard 16, trumpet 8, and the bombard 32.
Your musical life has been remarkable in many ways, I think, largely because you've managed to cram so much into it. There was the academic side when you directed the Antwerp Conservatoire, and then you managed to combine that with composition. You've written more for the organ than any other living composer, I think. You've given recitals all over the world, and at the same time, you've managed to look after a very charming family as well. It's now time to hear some records, and all the music I've chosen is either by you or by your great friend, Charles Tournemire. And the first piece I've chosen, selfishly, because it's one of my favourite Peeters pieces, is the neoclassical Lydian Prelude and Fugue. When did you write it?
I wrote it in 1950, and it was published in 51. And I came to the idea to write three preludes and fugues in the old modal style, on a classical but on the same, on a modern way.
Do you remember anything about the registration?
I think I can remember exactly what I had on the organ here in the cathedral. I had on the pedal the subbass 16, the bass 8, and the flute 4, coupled to the swell. And on the swell I had the whole pipe 8, the open flute 4, and the cymbal. And on the great I had the whole pipe 8, en de Veldvloed toe, met de koppel of de receipt. Dat was al voor de prelude.
Thank you.
The Prelude and Fugue in F, the Lydian by Flor Peeters. Next one of your many chorale preludes, the one on Sleeper's Wake. But incidentally, before we go on, do you remember exactly how many chorale preludes you've written?
It must be 323, I think.
323?
Yes.
And there was the big set, the last set you wrote, of 200. I think those were the ones you told me you wrote for an American publisher, who told you something about the character of the pieces.
It was an order by Peeters Edition from New York. And Walter Hendrickson, the president, said to me, now, I should like that you write for me the complete set for the whole liturgical year on chorale preludes. You will be the first in history who has done it, and I will be the first publisher who has done it. And he said to me, now, this chorale prelude should not be too long, not too difficult, and not too modern. So that were the conditions on which I had to work.
But this particular chorale prelude, the one on Sleeper's Wake, comes not from those, but from the Opus 68 set. It must have been quite difficult to avoid sounding like Bach in this prelude.
Well, I was thinking on it when I wrote Wach het auf, and I've written it in the same key as Johann Sebastian did it. But I have given to the right hand, to the concertato, and instead I have conceived the chorale as a homophone setting in the left hand on the special color of the reeds and the cymbal.
Thank you. Tournemire's own music, we're now going to a work of yours, which you dedicated to Tournemire. That was the Toccata, Fugue, and Hymn on Ave Maria Stella. When did you write that? Was that an early work?
That was a very early work. I have written that in 1929. And I wrote a fugue on a train between Hamburg and Köln. I couldn't sleep, so I wrote it there, and it was finished in Köln. So...
Well, it's lucky that you couldn't sleep. Did Tournemire ever hear the piece?
Oh, yes. I played it in St. Clotilde, and he liked it very much.
Before we hear the piece, could you just let us hear the theme that it's based on?
Mm-hmm. With pleasure.
What will you play it on?
Will I play it on the Kromhorn of the Positive?
Yes. Now, here's the Toccata, Fugue, and Hymn written by Flor Peeters on that tune you've just heard. Thank you.
That was the toccata, fugue and hymn on Ave Maris Stella.
Thank you.
Flor Peeters playing his own Mixolydian prelude and fugue.